Praise the Lord. So glad he's able to join you today. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Father God, we come to you today in the name of Jesus. We're so thankful, Lord, for our new covenant benefits and blessing we have through Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Jesus saved us, delivered us, redeemed us, and gave us eternal, everlasting, abundant life. We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's open our Bibles over here, please, to Mark chapter 11. In this one, Jesus has spoken to the fig tree, cursed it, and withered away. And the scripture says here in verse 22, and Jesus answered them, have faith in God. And then Jesus went on to say here, but verily I say unto you, that whosoever say in this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast in the sea, and shall not doubt, but shall believe that those things which you saith shall come to pass, he shall whatsoever saith. Now verse 24 says, therefore I say unto you, what things so desire when you pray, believe you receive them, and you shall have them. Now these are two ways that you and I as believers can release our faith. One way is by speaking to situations, like Jesus spoke to this fig tree. Actually, he's showing us here the power that's in words. He spoke to the fig tree and said, no man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard him. And when they went past that, they saw it dried up from the roots the next day. And that's when Jesus said, as they were amazed about this happened, when Jesus said, you'll have what you say. When he taught us there in Mark chapter 11, verse 23. Now, as believers, we always want to monitor what we say. We have to realize we came in the kingdom of God by confessing Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Remember Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. We may have called a, we said the sinner's prayer, or I received Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. But nevertheless, we used our mouth and we used our heart, our spirit man, to believe that we received Jesus. So Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10 tells it that if thou shalt confess thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in the heart God has raised dead, thou shalt be saved. For at the heart man believeth righteousness, with the mouth confession made salvation. Now verse 13 says, for whosoever calleth the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's how we receive Jesus Christ the Lord. Now, that was really unusual to me. I grew up in church and started out as a little kid, but I had no idea you're supposed to confess Jesus Christ the Lord. It wasn't that I didn't believe Jesus Lord. I just didn't know I should confess him and receive as my Lord and Savior. And so later on, when people begin to witness to me about, are you saved? Have you received Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior? But those people really bothered me. Yeah, they upset me, made me angry. What they do, they got me thinking. And they gave me scripture, because I didn't have any scripture. They gave me scripture. So finally, praise God, by God's grace and mercy, I received Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. The point is, that's how you and I came in the family of God. We confessed Jesus Christ, the Lord. We believed in our heart and confessed in our mouth that Jesus is Lord. Now, Jesus taught us here that he spoke to this fig tree and cursed it and withered away. And then also in Mark 4, we read before there, remember being in verse 35, that they woke him up and said, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he spoke to the wind and the waves, and it obeyed him. Now we can see here, this is why, one of the reasons why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, verse 37, a man or person judged or condemned by the words of his mouth, justified or condemned by the words of his mouth. It's what we say. And it does make the difference what you and I say. You know, no matter how many people poo-poo that and think it's preposterous, nevertheless, eventually we'll have what we say. And we can take scripture, let's take promises. Like we read there in 3 John verse 2, Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, as our soul prosper. Now maybe when I first heard that, to me, that was like off the charts. I just felt I was lucky to be saved and think that God had prosperity and health in his life for us. I must have thought that kicked in when you got to heaven. But anyway, I started saying that verse of scripture, decreeing and declaring what that verse said about me. Now, maybe at first I really didn't convince, I was convinced it was for me. Definitely I didn't think I was God's beloved. But nevertheless, I put my name there where it said beloved, and I say, Jesse, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health is a soul prosper. Now, the point of this is, like anything else, like when I heard ministers teach that we are the righteous of God in Christ, really couldn't understand why they put so much emphasis on that. What God was trying to help me is that I need to know that I'm right with God because of what Jesus did, not because of my wrongs and rights, what I've done or haven't done. Well, so I begin to say I'm the righteous of God in Christ, probably reluctantly, but probably knew in my heart I need to keep saying this. Soon after I got born again. Had no idea what righteous even meant. Well, as believers, we're going to be much more effective of dealing with problems that come up life if we know that we're right with God because of what Jesus did. Because you and I always come up short. Well, the point is, by saying I'm the righteous of God in Christ and taking scripture like 3 John verse 2 and saying, God, wish above all things that I prosper and be in health. Maybe at first I didn't really believe it, but what happened is the more you say it, the more you get convinced of it. And that's one of the reasons why the Lord would have us speak His word. Because, you know, if you grew up church like I did, you heard so many things that against having good health, against prosperity. I mean, sooner or later, it was there. If you took the wraps off of it, it'd be that, you know, God doesn't always heal, and God knows what's best. If He wants you to have it, He'll just give it to you. Nothing against these people. You know, I'm responsible for my own life. I can't blame them. And I don't think bad about them anyway. But the point was, I'm sure they, looking back at it, they were just teaching and believing what little bit of knowledge they have. And that's how all of us are. Whatever the amount of knowledge we have from God's word is usually what we end up believing. And as we take scripture, healing scriptures, financial scriptures, any of those problems like that, and we begin to say, maybe at first we really didn't believe it. But the more we said it, the more we believe it, the more confidence we become, the more fully persuaded we become. That's what reason, one of the reasons why it's important for you and I just keep repeating what the promises say about us. Like, one of the first ones I got was Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. But my God shall supply your need according to the rich glory of Christ Jesus. So I quit talking my needs. I tried to eliminate that word from my vocabulary. So with someone, even when that guy called me up, when I was unemployed, I've been confessing all the time that my God meets my needs and I have a job in Jesus' name. Talking about calling those things that be not as though they were. Well, this guy calls me up and just says, Jesse, do you have a job? Now, I didn't want to say, no, I don't have a job, because it seemed like that was negative. What little bit of knowledge I have, you know, I'm learning God's word. I mean, I'd heard Mark 11:23, you need to watch what you say. And I started realizing all the stuff I'm going through is what I've been saying all my life. Well, now I'm changing my vocabulary. I'm trying to speak God's word. I just know a few scriptures at the time. Well, I hesitate, and this is on the phone, I hesitate to answer his question. Now, he does the hiring at this place. I just stopped by 5 or 10 minutes ago to see if they needed anybody to do any work for him. And he said, Jesse, you have a job or not? Now, I knew him before, and I knew him afterwards. And I never ever saw him talk that way. And it jarred me. And I said, no, Bob, I don't. He said, well, be here Monday morning. Now, I don't know what happened to this situation here. It just, God got me this job. I wasn't qualified for it. And I wasn't, you know, that gifted in that. So I had to believe God that He'd make up the difference. Now, this is every day going on. First, I made mistakes. So then I could get in trouble, lose my job. This is back when they could fire you with no reason. And then also there was other installers came around that did a better job than I did and were going to do it at a better price, cheaper. So that was against me. Plus, then, you know, just, you got the devil doing stuff. Well, that's where I'm going to need Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. Now, I've been confessing, my God supplies all of my needs. Have no idea really what I'm getting into, but I knew I need to keep saying this. So then I kept saying I can do all things through Christ. That meant that I got to believe God to help me get through this job, that I can do this. And by God's grace and mercy, I had that job till I left to go to Bible school. It was an incredible job. But every day, it was a battle. Every day, you just wanted a vacation from all the problems were going on. But every day, I've got to speak God's word. I'm using my tithing scriptures, believing God, my job's protected. I just know a few scriptures. And, you know, I'm listening to people teach the word, faith tapes all the time. And so I leave to go to Bible school. And when I got to my first class, and that teacher said, Old Testament prophets. Class, and that teacher said, good morning. That's about the last thing I understood. He's using people's names, but I'm trying to figure out why we're in the Old Testament anyway, you know. So I thought I was believing God on my job for Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. Now I got to really use this scripture in Bible school. You got all these classes you're taking. It's been a while since I was in school, and, you know, a lot of these terms that I have no idea what they're saying, and we're going to have an examination in a few weeks. Okay. Got to battle through that. Plus, I got to pay for my rent. Plus, I got all these other bills going on. All these problems going on. Well, now, each one of these scriptures I've been using, and thank God I'm getting some more that Jesus has given to us, you know, learning, getting more knowledge of Him. Now I'm using these scriptures for it. So it's constantly in Bible school. It's just like you didn't get a break. I was speaking the word, praying the spirit, thanking God I'm passing the class, thanking God my rent's paid, thanking God my tuition's paid, thanking God my utility bills are paid, thanking God I'm working part-time and going to class also. So I'm thanking God I favor God, man, the place I'm working at, And of course, you got all these problems. The problems just increased. But I'm using scripture on these problems, really not knowing what I'm doing. I just know I have no other choice. It's not like I'm real spiritual. It's just I have to keep fighting myself through my way through all these battles. Finally get out of Bible school. By a miracle of God, I graduate. And all my bills have paid and got caught up by them. And then start traveling to ministry. I thought working that secular job was something. And I thought Bible school was something. I'm not trying to one-up you on problems. I'm just sharing this with you. It just comes to my heart. So now I've got to really use all the scripture I got that I can do for my ministry. Believe in God that I'm an able minister, New Testament. And taking scripture like that and quoting them. Believing I have favor with God, man. Believing that I'm anointed of God and all that. Plus all the other things that's going on. And all these problems. I got like 2 home Bible studies I'm doing every week. And the one had the most people, had the best offering, and actually the most successes in it. The lady decided she didn't want to have it anymore. So now I got this little one left. I got all these bills. I signed a contract for the apartment, everything else. And, you know, the rent was so high. It was like 3 times, almost 2.5 times more than what I paid for I got out when I was in Bible school. So this is like gigantic to me. And then as soon as I signed a contract, the lady that had was doing the Bible study in the Monday night one, she quit it. Oh boy, I don't have a telephone. I'm going down to this back when you had pay phones, you go down and use them. How can ministers get a hold of me? Churches wanted me to get, you know, when we come and preach, if they did hear about me, how would they even get a hold of me? Then I don't have a phone number. All these things going on. What am I doing? I'm using all those scriptures I've been learning. All those ministers who helped me grow and develop spiritually. And by listening to their, it'd be like CDs today. Listen to CDs over and over again. Not because, again, I'm real spiritual. Not because I'm real religious. I need somebody to keep feeding Jesse on God's word. And that's where the CDs come in today. And, you know, thank God we have the internet. You can tap into that. And that minister, you know, is teaching God's word. It's feeding me on the spirit. It's feeding me on my spirit, man, on God's word. And help me to deal with these situations. I thought everybody else just had, well, life was a piece of cake to them. They didn't have any. No, everybody's got to deal with stuff. So the point is, I'm using those scriptures to get a job. Finally, God, you know, got this job. Then I'm going to use those scriptures to keep my job. Then I'm going to use those scriptures to get into Bible school. Then I'm going to use those scriptures to get me through Bible school. Then lo and behold, I got into ministry. I guess I thought by the time you got through all that, everything was going to be a breeze. No, you got the same devil who comes around and brings doubt and unbelief. Now, what I have to do is answer that doubt and unbelief. And many times, I get up in the middle of the night, walking the floors, praising God and thanking God for rent's paid, thanking God in Jesus' name, and my bills are paid, my utility bills are paid. That was the biggest expenses I had. Believing God that I got a phone, a telephone, so people could get a hold of me, and just fighting constantly with those scriptures. Trying to sleep at night, the worry would come, the fear would come, the doubt would come, the unbelief would come. Get out of bed, start walking the floors, you know, quote my scriptures, take my Bible, and read scripture like, I always use Malachi chapter 3, verse 10 through 12, and other scriptures like that, my finances, thanking God in Jesus' name that these bills are paid, and I'm an able minister of the New Testament, I'm a booked up minister in the name of Jesus, decree and declare by favor with God, man, and God's anointed me in Jesus' name to teach his word, and on and on and on and on. Oh, thank God that I had those scriptures and still do to use. Because, you know, get down and do it, I didn't have anything else. And that's okay. Because God's word is what we build our life on. So when you and I have wondered about stuff that's going on maybe in our life, you know, like, you know, the disciples said, carest thou not to perish? Kind of like what Martha said about Mary sitting there listening to the word. What you and I are doing, it's like we're building our life on God's promises. Because that's what we have that's guaranteed, is his word. And when many times when we're quoting God's word all the time, reading the scriptures all the time, wondering, you know, when am I ever get done with doing this? No, it's always something we're going to be doing. And it's okay. Because what I didn't realize, all the time I'm believing God for this job, all the time I'm going to use scriptures to keep the job, and all the time I'm going to use scriptures to get me through Bible school, and all the time I'm using scriptures to get me, you know, get my ministry going and keep it going, I'm getting built up. It's just like if a person went to the gym and kept working out, and they got a trainer. This trainer is constantly torturing them in their own mind, thinking, I want you to do this, I want you to do that, and you know, and they give you this lecture about what you've been eating, and on, that stuff's no fun. I mean, not unless you're really into it. But yeah, you get to thinking about, what good is this doing? Why has this person put me through all this? And you go day after day, week after week, month after month, and all of a sudden, begin to realize that this stuff you've been doing, this routine, is kicking in. Now, maybe we didn't know that at first. Well, spiritual things are a lot like that. Maybe physical things are that way because spiritual things are that way. And so we do this rehearsal with God's Word, and we're reading promises and wondering, you know, why did I do all this? Because many times our mind wants to do something else, or our flesh wants to do something else other than every day get up, pick up our Bible, go back to those scriptures, reread those scriptures, reapply those scriptures to life. Why we listen to ministers teaching stuff that we've already heard before over and over and over again? Because we're getting built up, whether we realize it or not. And that makes us more adapted to be able to apply God's Word to life. We're better conditioned to deal with something when it comes up. Because whether we realize it or not, all this time, we and I have been praising God and thanking God that we're healed, praising God and thanking God our bills are paid, thanking God and praising God that we have the mind of Christ, praising God and thanking God for whatever else we're praising God and thanking God for. All the time we're doing that, quoting scriptures. You know, I don't know if Joshua had any idea about this when God said, be thou strong, be thou very courageous. I mean, he just inherited this responsibility. That Moses is gone now, and we're talking about Moses, look what he could. He could have water out of a rock. And look how mightily God used him. Now Joshua's in this situation. And God said, be thou strong, be very, very courageous. But then he told him how to do it. In verse 8, he said, meditate on my word day and night, and don't let the word depart from your mouth. Now I don't know if Joshua realizes that 10 more chapters later, or 9 more chapters later, in chapter 10, he's going to be in a battle, and he needs the sun to stand still for a while. He's going to speak to it. He's going to speak to the moon and get it to stop. Look what the preparation did for him. He apparently must have done what God told him to do. And God told us as the church, the body of Christ, in Ephesians, kind of like the same thing as telling Joshua, be thou strong, be strong, Lord, in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. And finally, verse 17, use the sword of spirit, which is the word of God. That's the word coming out of our mouth, speaking God's word. Sure, with all respects, in your own mind, carnal nature, whatever we call it, it could get repetition, it could get boring. And I had no idea by doing this that I was building up myself spiritually all the time that I'm doing all this. Looking back, you thought, wow, God really got me. He got me through Bible school. He got me that job that I wasn't even qualified for, and that was a miracle. But looking back at it, he kept it for me by his grace and mercy. Got this guy to call me one day who didn't even want me, you know? And a great guy. I don't know anything wrong about the guy. I wish I could run across him sometime. Well, now I don't know any of this. And see, that's a lot of times what's going on, you and I. We're reading scripture every day, praying, you know, getting up in the middle of the night, thanking God for healed, thanking God for delivered, whatever it is. You know, everybody's got something. It's building us up all along. And Jesus, you know, is teaching us that he did all this for us. What we're trying to do is convince ourselves that it belongs to us. Sometimes we're not trying to earn healing or prosperity or anything else. We're trying to convince ourselves this is belong to me, convincing that devil. I'm prosperous because God's word says I am. And I'm healed because God's word says I am. He's the one that brings doubt to us. We all doubt every day. Doubt comes to us all the time. It wasn't something we picked up on. It was just brought to us. And we need to talk to that fear and that doubt, not unbelief. Fear's terrible. Worry's terrible. It's terrible. I mean, you hate to see a little child worried or an elderly person worried about something. You're always trying to calm them down. Don't worry. How about you and I? Think of all the things we've worried about, fretting about. Think of all the things that were told us about our life and our future. All that worry, all those thoughts that come to our minds. Think about this. That's why we need God's promises. That's why we need to keep praising God and thanking God, letting the enemy know I'm not quitting in Jesus' name. And stand with one another. People get weak. They get depressed. They get upset. But this stuff comes to all of us. And thank God for a brother or sister that will help keep us jacked up in God's word. You could have a friend, just, you know, a believer, share some scripture with you. You know, I remember one time this preacher that he's got a decent ministry, man, size ministry. He calls me up. And I thought, wow, this comes up to my phone. Right? Hello, you know. He says, Jeff, you know, Jesse, tell me something. Tell me about what God's done. Now, this guy has been mightily used by God. He's calling me up. What does he want to hear? wants to hear me say something that's going to, he's going to lock in on. And I realized what was going on. Now, I don't want to say what I believe God for. That's like, you know, taking a 10. I don't like doing that. But I realized what's going on here. He was in a moment. His wife and him, I didn't know at the time, they're going to take their house from him. This house is nice. And they were behind payments 10 months. And the bank had already sent the letters. And they just refused to give in. They hadn't even packed a pair of socks yet. Nothing. Packed up nothing yet. And you got to realize the sheriff's coming and putting them out. That's the day I got the call. I don't know this is going on. What? Tell me all the miracle finances that God's done for you. Well, my rent was no comparison to this mortgage he's got. My rent was like this compared to his, you know, monster he's got. And he wants to hear. You know, and praise God, you know, a testimony helps other believers. Discouragement comes to all of us. We know to resist it. We know we're not supposed to think about it. We know we're just supposed to refuse it. You know, we even talk well. But now and then, you know, you're sharing with your testimony to someone else, encourage them to use God's word and, you know, how you believe God and God, what do you got? That's encouraging another person. He didn't need someone talking from their head right now. He needs somebody who'd been through some kind of trial and knew how to fight their way through it. And you know what? God worked the whole thing out for him. Miraculously, and the bank never took the house. Not upset that bank, they didn't. Nothing against the bank, okay? So what happened is, maybe strike that last statement, but anyway, you know, maybe they didn't get upset. Oh, but they did. But anyway, so you've got things that come up to you. And a lot of times, you know, you can share that with other person. Ask God leads you. You know, share with some other person. You're not bragging. You know, they just need to hear a good testimony right now, what Jesus did. And that's what the body of Christ is supposed to stand with one another and believe God with one another. Now, we may not just have a few friends that can do that, but nevertheless, you know, sometimes you need to see someone to talk faith to you and talk the word to you. Other times you just need somebody to kind of listen to you. And you and I, whenever he sends the Spirit of God, what this person really needs at the time. And thank God for that, you know. That we can do that. One will put 1,000 fly, two put 10,000 fly. How can they two walk together unless they agree? The two of us shall agree on earth to touch anything they shall ask. It should be done for them. Follow it 7. We're supposed to be in one accord in the body of Christ. We're not supposed to be in strife. We're not supposed to be dividing up teams and coming against each other. No, we're on the same team. The idea is to get the ball past the goal. Now, we're going to do that by all participating together. Because we're coming against these demon spirits who are defeated. And every Christian has to remind themselves, these demons are defeated. They're underneath our feet. But these demons bring doubt. They bring worry. They bring depression, oppression. Constantly. To try to weaken the Christian, try to run them down. Try to get them to quit, try to get them to give up. And we need to stand with one another. And to encourage one another, pray for one another. You know, we all know we need to do that. I know I need to pray for people. I do, you know. No, not that kind of prayer. Praying where we're really, you know, up at night praying for someone. Because we know they're going through some kind of trial and coming against all those evil forces that are coming against them. And of course, you know, share the word with them. And not talk down to them or condescending or act like you don't understand why you got this problem. Everybody's got something they got to face. You may not understand what some other brother or sister are going through, but if some of the devil, we're supposed to stand against it. I want to encourage you, hold fast your confession of faith. Keep listening to ministers to keep you built up on God's word. You know, it's so beneficial for us to keep ourselves built up in God's word. We know faith comes by hearing by the word of God, but we take those promises and use them in those battles that we're faced with. And just keep speaking God's word and be determined. Father God, I thank you what your word says. I thank you, Father God. In the name of Jesus, that according to your word be done to me. Father God, I pray for each dear person today. I thank you, Lord, they're healed, they're delivered, they're redeemed because of what Jesus did. And we thank you, Lord, we can stand together in one accord. We thank you the body of Christ is going forth and doing great things in Jesus' name. We give you all the praise and glory, Father, and we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Really enjoyed being here today. I'm so glad you was able to watch today. Till next time, Brother Rich, remind you, Jesus is always more than enough.